Hello, my dear friend. Today we are going to discuss need of pharmacovigilance for Ayurvedic formulation. This lecture is based on our presentation in a webinar conducted at Government Ayurvedic Medical College, Bangalore. Pharmacovigilance is the need of present time for every type of medications. As if we see the etymology of word pharmacovigilance, or it is derived from Greek word pharmakon, which means for drug, and vigile, a Latin word which means for to keep watch. Even WHO has emphasized this pharmacovigilance in relation to detection, assessment, understanding and prevention of adverse effect or any other drug related problem. Actually, this is the fourth phase of clinical research, which links pre-marketing data with human safety information observed in post-marketing phase. The word pharmacovigilance was officially used by McBride. It was published in The Lancet in December 1961, related with adverse effect of thalidomide, which was used to be given as anti-emetic and sedative agent in pregnant women. Details you can see from here. The history of pharmacovigilance in India, whenever we are talking, this starts in 1986 when an advanced drug reaction monitoring system was established with 12 centers in India, but that was not successful. Later, India joined WHO ADR's monitoring program based in Uppsala, Sweden in 1997. Even this effort was also not successful. Then, in January 2005, WHO sponsored and World Bank funded National Pharmacovigilance Program came in existence. And by that time only, amendment was done in Drug and Cosmetic Act 1940, where post-marketing phase was emphasized to study additionally with drug-drug interactions, dose response, safety studies and trials designs to support use under the approved indications, as mortality, morbidity studies, epidemiological studies, etc. Studies in special population like use of drug in children, pregnant women, geriatric patients, or patients with renal or other organ failures, etc., were made mandatory in Schedule Y. But it was left on drug licensing authority to cross and review license based on these studies. Whenever we talk about the pharmacovigilance in Ayurveda, in 2008 and 9, first time IPGT and RA was recognized as National Pharmacological Resource Center for Pharmacovigilance of ASU drug. This was according to the guidelines of WHO. More coordination centers were also recognized. Nowadays, many centers are there under that. Coordination centers, lot of coordination centers are there. Even Government Ayurvedic College, Bangalore is one of that. So we come to know that pharmacovigilance is essential as suggested by WHO. Because WHO in 2005 said that it's disgusting if anyone is still dying due to lack of medicine. But it is unacceptable if anyone is dying due to medicine. It means side effects should be very less, and healthcare professionals must know the rational use of medicine. Now see some of the recommended steps by WHO. WHO has always emphasized on improvement of patient care and safety while using medicine, medical or any type of paramedical intervention. For that, public health programs enhancement are suggested and conducted through collection of information on effects of drugs with warning about specific products, detection of problems while using medicines, and communications of findings are also noted down along with the assessment of benefits and harms. We all know that life of human being is too much important and no one has right to play with the life. So if we know exactly the things, then only we should prescribe specific medicine. Otherwise, it's a matter of immoral practicing as well as it's against the law also. So WHO encouraged safe, rational and effective medicines. They suggested the understanding, education and clinical training for pharmacovigilance and its effective communications to public, because public participation is very much important in this case. If public is not knowing about the medicine or their effects today or tomorrow or in any future, they will not report these things. So ultimately, to know completely about the effects in terms of side effects or any problematic effects, participation of public is too much important. Now we will see why we need pharmacovigilance for Ayurvedic formulations. So here we will discuss some of the points. As you will see that Ayurvedic formulations have lack of evidence in terms of documentations based on animal experiments. Because in Ayurveda you will find those prescriptions are based on indications and we are just carrying those things. We have no scientific documents along with that. We know that Ayurveda's origin lies in antiquity. It's more than 1,000 years, 2,000, 5,000 different authors have different claims. You just imagine the environment that time. That time environment was totally different from the present time. Nowadays you will find pollutions are a lot of them. Different types of pollutions are there. Even we also know that it's the nature's law that there is continuous changes in genetic makeup with change in lifestyle, climatic condition or many other factors. So what we think, whether those same plant have not changed their genetic makeup in terms of genotypes. I'm not talking about the phenotypes, because a lot of things you will find what they have given to identify the plants, they are similarly appearing. And we know that a specific gene is guiding the synthesis of various metabolites. So whether the same compounds are present at present time also or not, we don't know. So we need documentation. This is the reason we need the details about the effect by various experiments so that we can find whether to support those things or not. So a lot of chemical experiments are needed. One of Vaidya suggested reverse pharmacology for that. That's the need of time. Another thing is, we don't have documents too much based on clinical research. Prior to marketing, we know that there are four or five phases. Like zero phase, if we see, that's related with pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamics of drugs. And first phase of clinical research is related with safety, efficacy, side effects, etc. Number of subjects are given, that's limited numbers are there. Second phase is related to proof concept, means the effect of drug on 100 to 300 patients. While in third phase, it's going on higher number, usually up to 3000 or sometimes more. After that, drug is launched to market. So number of times, as we have seen, that these are the limited number of people. So various side effects based on interactions with different meals or other drugs already taken by the consumers are coming in existence, or those are reported by the various people or consumers. That's why pharmacovigilance is required. That's exactly the fourth phase of clinical research. Another point, if we see, identification of signals related with ADRs for Ayurvedic formulations. Signals means what? Those signs and symptoms which we are not previously mentioned. But if they are related with a specific ADR, a lot of ADRs, we must note it down. That's needed. Because even in clinical research, if we have performed in case, then we have performed on limited subjects. Even the population was very narrow in terms of age and sex. We have not checked all the ages. We have not classified based on different sex. Or if that is even done, then every single age group according to body makeup is not done. So a lot of loopholes are there. Even number of these drugs are not done on specific populations. Those documentations are usually prepared from pharmacovigilance. As we know that, like if we talk about lot of rasa dravya in specifically mercury formulations in Ayurveda, we know that after exposure, the greater proportion of body burden of mercury is in kidney. Mercury may be in any form, inorganic, organic, elemental form or whatever. Whether we check every single patient after giving those mercury drug, that whether this is coming out of with urine or fecal matter or not. Even while preparing those drugs also, if during heat treatment those are converting in vapor forms, whether we are taking all the precautions. These things we will come to know when we are looking to biological half-life of mercury. That's usually 30 to 60 days. But in case, if mercury has reached to brain or various brain tissues, and there it is estimated that half-life may reach up to 20 years. Depositions may be there, and their exposures in terms of adverse effect may come quite later. The details These are given over there in terms of reference. By that time, people used to forget that what they were given with certain medications or not. These things are required during pharmacovigilance. This is the reason why we need pharmacovigilance. We have to follow like a cohort study to those patients and to see whether this is coming in 20 years, 30 years as any side effect or not. If after all these things it's not coming, then only we can say this is okay or this is safe. Otherwise, a lot of reports are there where people have got various complications due to this. Another point is assessment of these signals with clinical relevance, causality, frequency and distribution among ADRs. Here we will see another example. We know that arsenic acids are water soluble, number of them, and there other arsenic salts are rapidly absorbed from GI tract. But some of the arsenicals, like arsenic trioxide, they are poorly soluble. The absorption of arsenic trioxide is dependent upon physical form of compound, and coarsely powdered material may be eliminated in feces through significant dissolution and absorption, or soluble arsenic salts may also be absorbed following inhalation and through skin. While preparing the arsenic drugs, you will find that if you are giving the treatment, a lot of times yellowish red, those colors are coming out on that, along this, on neck of that. That's the complete dangerous gas, arsenic gas is there. So you should be very much careful about those things. So once absorb arsenic, they are going to liver, kidney, heart and lungs. Very small amount is reaching to muscles and nervous tissue. After 2 weeks of ingestion, arsenic is deposited in hair and nails and remain fixed to the keratin for years. There is no such reports. That's here you will find in reference also. It is also deposited in bones and teeth. Number of cases we have seen with falling tooth and all. Even then, this may create after 7 years, 6 years of this treatment with the specific drug containing arsenic, that may appear in terms of rashes and all. So such type of things are not usually connected with whatever given with that patient. These are the things we need, that's why we need pharmacovigilance. If we see another one example, like determination of rate of events of ADRs with Ayurvedic formulation, we know that lead is cleared from the blood and soft tissues with a half-life of 1 to 2 months, and it's slowly going out from skeleton, where the half-life may be for the decades. So 70% of lead excretion occurs via the urine, while the very lesser amount is through fecal matter and very small amount through sweat, hair and nails. Lot of side effects are suggested in terms of vomiting, hypotension, muscle weakness, cramps, and all these things are there. Even that produces CNS symptoms. Gastrointestinal and cardiovascular effects are there. Hepatic damages are there. Renal effects are there. So whether we have gone through in details with this, because here you will find that even a small amount is reaching up to brain and that causing CNS effects. And that's remaining there and that's deposited in different parts and that's being there for years. So it side effects are appearing quite later. We need to know about these effects in details. That's why we need pharmacovigilance in Ayurvedic formulations. Even if we are talking about the determination of risk factors, if you know that if you are giving ashwagandha regularly, a lot of physicians give ashwagandha regularly to the patients for general debility and for other reasons also. But if we are giving regularly ashwagandha, that increases GABA. We know that this is inhibitory neurotransmitter that slows the brain function. This is the reason this is used in relieving anxiety, reducing stress, or improving sleep. But it may also bring down the blood pressure. So whether we have checked that whom we are giving, they are suffering from hypotension or not? Whether we have checked that, whether they, whom we are giving, they were already having those due to less excitatory neurotransmitter problems, created problems? We are not checking. Exactly, we don't know about the interactions also. But we need to know. This is the reason it should be given. This is the reason we need pharmacovigilance for this, even for herbal drugs also. Even for serotonin, if we see, that level is increased by Shilajit. A number of other drugs are there, even you will find in those almond and lot of dry fruits also. This is the reason it is called as mood elevator also. So that's related with declarative memory, if it is reaching to corticohippocampal dopamine. And it is, one research is done on mice, then it is found that it's directly related with that. So if we are giving this drug, as well as by the time if we have given the mucona also, whether we have studied that synergetic effects or other interactions. Because if there is effect, is there in improvement or enhancement of the effect, then it's good. But if it is inhibitory, having inhibitory effects, then we need to study. Because human beings are not a laboratory animal. We have to think all the safety points for them. This happens with number of herbal drugs also. That's why we need pharmacovigilance in Ayurveda. And this is the reason, even if as a physician, if you are prescribing medicine, it should be rational use of medicine. Suppose some of the patient was given with valerian officinalis, along with many of us, those are depressant, like ephedra, etc. So what will be the effect? Have we evidences? No. So pharmacovigilance becomes important to collect evidences from the consumers, based on variation in physiological body. Yeah, response will come differently from different physiological body, that's true. We need to study these things, no? That's why pharmacovigilance is required. Even it is required because a lot of ethical concepts are not clear. Ethical concept, whenever we are talking, that relate to transparency or publicly acceptable risk benefit profile, public trust, minimization of stigma, or any other obligations for vulnerable people. So these things, whether a lot of times, are not clear. So that's why we need pharmacovigilance. Pharmacovigilance is needed to increase communications and recommendations to authority and public. It is needed for appropriate response of action in drug use. It is needed to educate people. It is needed to train people for that, so that people should be aware and should know is to they should be so much conscious that whatever effects they are getting in themselves, they must report for that, because they are the best judge. That's why we need pharmacovigilance. If measurement and evaluation of outcome of response is there, if any patient is experiencing ADRs, then we need this. And whatever reports we are getting, that should be given to feedback to clinicians. So clinicians should be aware what to use, how to use, why to use. And related information should be there with licensing authority to take appropriate actions whenever required. So pharmacovigilance is needed a lot for Ayurvedic medicines. Once the people will have all the scientific proofs, automatic belief will start increasing towards Ayurvedic medicines. Because Ayurvedic formulations, number of them are there, they are extraordinary in terms of effects. So we should proceed scientifically across the globe. Its recognition will automatically come. So accordingly, some proposals are there. We have to make robust and transparent pharmacovigilance system for Ayurveda, where all these things must be reported and should be taken care of strictly. There must be mandatory clinical review of case reports and post-marketing reports. We should not just let it go for passing and all. Everything documentation should be there, so that if any claims are coming apart from or just in opposition of documentations, and those claims are more than whatever is written, so appropriate action for who have documented that must be also taken. Because ultimately it's about the safety of human being. Cohort event monitoring should be there. That must be in prospective way for long term, till these side effects are appearing. There must be spontaneous recording. Spontaneous recording, if anyone is claiming that this is an adverse effect, there must be recording when any physician is prescribing medicine to patient also. That talk also be recorded. So if any matter of negligence is there, that should reach to court. And that should be given to government. Government must collect that. Government must make a system where whatever prescriptions are given, that should automatically reach to them by the different stages of authorities. That will only help in transparent and healthy healthcare system. So periodic safety update is essential in this case to inform clinicians as well as all people related with healthcare system and common people also. We have to record linkage with permission to use. Database should be there for various type of formulations. From what people should also get awareness about the different usage, effects, side effects, actions, interactions of various Ayurvedic formulations based on dosage and other things. So we cannot say that any of this drug is not, or so we cannot say that Ayurvedic formulations are not having side effects. Nothing in this world is there without any side effect. You must know, we must know. If even we are taking meals also in food, those are also having side effects. Number of times, like pineapple if you are taking, so that are having also synergetic effect with various compounds. Even if we are taking garlic, that's also dilate vessels. So accordingly, if other vasodilators we have taken, and then we are going to take garlic, or after garlic we have taken, so that may go in other way, either positively or negatively, depending upon physiological body and need of that vasodilation over there. So we should know in details about this, and public should be aware, that should be made aware by the system. These are the reasons why we need pharmacovigilance in Ayurvedic formulations. Thank you. Thanks a lot. If you like this video, please share, like this video, subscribe this channel. Number of such things will be coming to you in very scientific way, all related with Ayurveda or Ayurvedic practices. So thanks again. Thanks a lot.